all sides heading towards a final agreement on a peace plan. It's the people of South Ossetia that have borne the brunt of the conflict. Charlotte Lumis-Farley looks back at the past 5 days in South Ossetia and Abkhazia.
More than 2,000 people killed, many more wounded, and thousands forced to flee their homes. The result of 5 days of fierce fighting in South Ossetia. A war of claim and counterclaim, and one which has left a city in ruins, with most buildings reduced to rubble. The reason? Georgian President Mikhail Saakashvili has accused Russia of provoking the war to justify an invasion. The Russians say Saakashvili attacked first to try to gain control of South Ossetia. Fighting began in the evening on Thursday when Georgia launched a surprise operation, sending a large force against the breakaway republic, reaching the capital, Tsimvali. Streets came under a hail of fire as Georgian forces met strong resistance from separatist units in South Ossetia. The next day, in response, Russia poured troops and armor into the region amid claims its peacekeepers were being targeted.
With my own eyes, I saw how they've been finishing off soldiers. I was very afraid. There were moments when I was wounded. I saw the man who shot at me from his rifle-attached grenade launcher. I was hoping he'd finish me faster. And when I fell on my stomach, I was amazed he hesitated to do that. And then I turned around and saw that he was killed by a major who was with us. The major shot him just moments before he was able to finish me off.
Thousands fled the city of Tsimvali in panic. Most of them headed to Russia's Republic of North Ossetia, leaving everything behind.
My child wants to go home, and I have to tell him, we have no home left. It was destroyed. Your toys were destroyed. I'm thanking God our daddy is alive. He doesn't want to leave South Ossetia. I wouldn't have left either if it wasn't for the child. But what kind of life is this when you know your loved ones are being murdered and raped? I don't know how to classify what's happening there. Georgians, who call themselves Democrats, are killing women and children.
It was indescribably horrible there. Very scary. We're hiding in the basements with our children. Some are still there with no food or water. They're crying, sending us messages, pleading for help. We're watching TV all the time in the hope we'll get some information about our loved ones. Our city is in ruins, and we don't know what we'll come back to.
But not everyone was able to escape the fighting. Those left behind sheltered from the heavy fire in their cellars, without food and water, and not knowing what was going to happen.
For 4 days, kids had been sitting on the floor in the basement without water. We managed to escape, so we could take them back to Vladikavkaz. Later we got caught under fire, but managed to survive. My mother, all my brothers and other relatives remained back in Tsimvali. I drove the children here, and now I'm going back.
We went down to the basement, but when they found out where we were, they flooded it with water. We spent 3 hours standing in the water. The children were crying, they were cold. They started bombing us while we were trying to find another shelter. One little boy died. After several more hours in another basement, we were told we had 3 hours to leave the city. But while we were leaving Tsimvali, we were bombed.
International aid agencies expressed grave concern for civilians. The reports that ambulances couldn't move, overflowing hospitals, and surgery taking place in corridors. Russian president defended Russia's reasons for the attack.
The actions of the Georgian side led to deaths. Among them are Russian peacekeepers. The situation reached the point that Georgian peacekeepers had been shooting at Russian peacekeepers. Now children, women, old people die in South Ossetia. Most of them are citizens of the Russian Federation. According to the Constitution, I, as the President of the Russian Federation, must protect the lives and the dignity of the Russian citizens wherever they are. Those responsible for the deaths of our citizens will be punished.
And all this on the day the world was watching fireworks elsewhere, the opening ceremony of the Beijing Olympics. But attention was soon averted, and world leaders called upon to give their response, including Prime Minister Putin.
It's a shame that during the opening of the Olympics, when all weapons traditionally are silent, we have the reverse. On the day of the Olympic opening, the Georgian leadership has taken very aggressive steps against South Ossetia and virtually started hostilities using heavy weaponry, artillery, tanks, and there are victims, and it will, of course, draw a reciprocal action.
But Georgian President Saakashvili denied this, accusing Russia of seeking to destroy his country and calling on the West to help.
I think the world should wake up to this painful reality and do something about it.
War continued into Saturday, with Russia claiming to have wrested control of the South Ossetian capital from Georgian forces. But fighting didn't stop there and now began moving further afield. Russian planes attacked military targets in the central Georgian town of Gori, and bombs hit a residential area. Georgia reports 60 deaths, something Russian forces strongly denied.
Our reconnaissance planes detect Georgian troops and task forces of the second echelon, their reserves that will be deployed against Hinvali and in other directions, and they are our targets. We strike them, but in such cases Georgians distort facts. They name villages, cities, communities located in the proximity, saying the Russian Air Force targets them. With full responsibility, I can state that Russia has not targeted a single village.
While delegations of peace envoys from the US, EU and OSCE headed to Georgia, a war of words erupted around the table in New York. The Russian ambassador to the UN, Vitaly Cherkin, not mincing his words to describe the report of more than 2,000 people killed.
Should we describe it as genocide? Now, when out of 120,000 population, over 2,000 die, is this genocide or is it not? How many civilians must die before we describe it as genocide?
But this was met with a strong warning from the US.
I urge the Russian Federation to carefully consider the implications of this aggression against the sovereign and democratic state of Georgia.
First hints of a halt to the violence came on Sunday. Georgia said it had ordered its troops to begin a ceasefire, to withdraw from South Ossetia, and that Russians were now in full control of the capital city. But that was counter to other reports of Russia saying clashes were continuing. Georgians killed children. A girl was running to her basement and she was shot dead. My neighbor, a boy who decided to bring us water to drink, was killed the second he appeared. By this time, fighting wasn't limited to South Ossetia. In Georgia's other breakaway region of Abkhazia, separatists announced a full military offensive to drive out Georgian forces who had fled the disputed Kadori Gorge, violating international agreements. Russian peacekeepers deployed in the area got the order to leave. They did so for the first time since 1994, when the peacekeeping mission was first set up. Local residents were forced to leave with them in fear for their lives.
We've already survived one war here, in this house. Those kids were first-year school children when the first war broke out. Now war's getting them again. He went to school during that war, and now he holds a gun. We've already had to wake up in the middle of the night, going through mountain passes in snow to survive.
Tension continued to rise into Monday, with Russia sending thousands of troops to the region and later moving from Abkhazia into Georgian territory. Meanwhile, the full scale of the humanitarian crisis started to come to light. Russia reported more than 30,000 refugees had fled north into the province of North Ossetia. While out of the war zone, they now endured the agony of leaving loved ones behind.
Please help us. We have nothing left. I'm begging you.
Georgians burst into the city. We had to take shelter in basements. They killed everyone who was in their way. They spared nobody. They trampled people with tanks. They beheaded Ossetians. We escaped only with great difficulty. They shot at us. It was horrible.
Despite promises of a ceasefire, both Russian and Georgian forces continued attacks. Only on Tuesday did words turn into action, with the Russian president ordering an end to the military operation against Georgia. And at the same time, shuttle diplomacy between Moscow and Tbilisi has provided a light at the end of the tunnel. Charlotte Lemus-Farley, RT, Moscow.